Well, you know, I can't say anything further today until I thank, as you would guess, the most important people in my life, and that, of course, is my family. Karen, Em, and Reese, love you to pieces. And, you know, I have to tell you, you know who the real star of the Kasich family is. It's Karen Kasich, my great wife. She is the real star in this family. And then to the members of my extended family who are here today, you know, thanks for your love, your support, and everything you've done for me. You know, when you think about it, Uncle George, it's hard to believe, isn't it? It's hard to believe that road from McKees Rocks to Ohio and what has happened. And as I told my sister-in-law, Chris, this is our family's triumph. It's not mine. We all share in it. We all embrace it. And I can't thank you enough. And to the supporters and staff and friends of mine that I've had for so many years, you know, I can remember in 1977 making cold calls out of a phone book and getting people to agree to have me in their home and to bake cookies and make coffee and invite their neighbors in. You know, their passion, their generosity, their creativity, their hard work, the work of the volunteers, the people who raise the money, it's all built on them. Everything, the whole foundation was built on these folks, these middle-class, hard-working folks who gave me a chance. And here's what, some of them are with us, some of them are gone, and they may be looking down. You know, they're in my mind's eye every day. No decision gets made where they are not in my mind's eye about what is fair, what is honest, what is removed from special interest groups. Because, folks, I'm fighting for you. That's who is in my mind, the folks that built this country and the folks that built this state. And I want to thank those supporters, and many of them are here today. Would you please recognize them and thank them for their hard work? Well, thanks, Mary Taylor. Not an easy job being Lieutenant Governor John Kasich, I gotta tell you. And to the people of our state, unbelievable. We've been through a difficult patch, haven't we? Yes, but we hung together. Some had doubts in the beginning, but we hung together. We stayed strong. We took a lot of risks, and we really never gave up as a people. People just stayed hardworking, brave, caring. And of course, you know, I mean, put yourself in my shoes for a second. Serving the people of the state of Ohio as the governor of Ohio is one of the greatest honors of my lifetime, and I'm so grateful for the people for giving me a chance to serve. Plain and simple. They're just fantastic folks, and God bless you. No single person is getting Ohio back on track. The gains that we've seen, we're all part of the same team. You know, a leader can provide vision, leader can help motivate, but that's just part of what it takes to get things together. We have our own unique roles to play, each and every one of us. Together, we have pulled Ohio out of the ditch, John, haven't we? We've tuned up the machinery, and we have Ohio back on the road again. And together, we're gathering speed. We're charting the course. We're moving forward. And together, we're reaching out to more and more of our neighbors and friends who had been left behind. And we're giving them a chance to share in the growing prosperity of our state. This is our work. This is Ohio's work. And look how far we've come. 4 years ago, there were many people who just thought things couldn't get better. I had one person say to me, John, I don't know why you want to do this. It's pretty much lost here in Ohio. A lot of people couldn't see a bright future, and many felt the tension that fear can bring. It was a fear of never being able to succeed, and I think we know this about fear. It can paralyze. It can douse our creativity, and fear had Ohio firmly in its grip. We'd lost jobs. We'd lost employers. People had lost their homes and their savings. And many folks in this great Buckeye State had gone bankrupt. All we felt were the hits, and the hits just seemed to keep coming. And government wasn't doing its part to make things any better. The institutions we had created to do the things that we really couldn't do for ourselves, the institutions were broken. They were failing. They cost too much. We weren't getting results, and worse, they weren't listening to Ohioans. In some cases, hassling Ohioans. And despite the fact that we, the people, are the boss. Well, folks, I and my team looked at the situation here in Ohio and thought about whether we wanted to provide the energy and hope we had the solutions. And we had no doubt. I never had a doubt in my mind that Ohio's greatness could be restored. We've got everything that it takes in the state of Ohio, and we charted a course for a new day using a new way, and we know it's paid off. And you need to understand, in our administration, we don't focus on politics. We don't care about politics. Oh, you can't just be, just going ahead at 100 miles an hour. But political considerations, that's not what drives this administration. Sometimes we'll sit in a meeting and things will get tense, try to figure out what we should do. And there's always a voice that speaks up in that room that says, remember why we came here. We came here to do the right thing. And that has been our motto and our course and our DNA. We worked on making government run efficiently and effectively and run more like a business. And let me tell you, when you do that, you can produce better results and more for people with less government and even less spending. It's amazing if you think outside of the box and you know how to innovate. We balanced Ohio's budget in a sustainable way. I'm told today that there are 20 states in America that are facing severe budget problems. Remember, we were $8 billion in the hole. We had 89 cents in our rainy day fund. Now we are structurally balanced with a $1.5 billion surplus here in the great state of Ohio. That's what people expect. You know, job creation, of course, has been and always will continue to be our greatest moral purpose. I've told you this for now going on 5 years. Why? Because I remember what it was like when the wind blew the wrong way in McKees Rocks and some dad had to go home, tell his family, I don't have a job. We got to change. Things will be rougher. But I can also remember when that dad went home, and today that mom goes home and says, I got hired. I got a new job. Because you know what it does? It restores personal confidence. You talk to a person who is out of work. They begin to doubt themselves. But when they get a job, it restores personal confidence. It's the kids. Kids, tonight, we're going out for a special dinner. Because I got a job. You may even be able to get a shrimp cocktail. And it leads, of course, to a more meaningful life. Therefore, in an effort to create a more friendly job climate in Ohio, we transformed this broken-down economic development system where they could not even figure out how to answer the phones. And we created the most innovative economic development approach in America. For those that are not sure, you ask around the country. They all want to figure out, how did you create Jobs Ohio? And how is it that you are beginning to win companies like GE and Procter & Gamble and IBM and the world's leading IT companies are all lining up to be part of this? Economic growth, it's great. But there's one thing that people in my political party don't always understand. Economic growth is not an end unto itself. Economic growth provides the means whereby we can reach out and help those who live in the shadows. You see, it's sort of like when mom and dad are financially healthy, they can do more to help the kids. But when mom and dad don't have anything, everyone suffers. But here in Ohio, we are taking the economic gains we have to give everyone in Ohio a chance to be lifted. And let me be clear, it is our goal that all people in our state, Todd Davidson, share in the growing economic prosperity, particularly those people who are part of our minority community. They must feel included, and they must feel that they have an opportunity equal to everyone else in the state of Ohio. We need to be united. Folks, we took a social services network, and this is still a work in progress, that treated the children of God like they were a number. Come in, get in line, we'll give you your help, and then see you next month. Let me just stamp it, and let's not even find out who you are or what your problems are. And we're transforming it so that taxpayers can get the value that they deserve, but that Ohioans in need can get a helping hand and a hand up, so they can reach their God-given potential. We took an education system that was fixated on adults and buildings and equipment. We reset our priorities so educators can focus on their calling, which is serving children. Well, we've made a lot of progress. Third grade reading guarantee. Kids doing so much better, not being deprived of their future because they could not read. But ladies and gentlemen, we need to reform an agrarian education system where everyone was stuffed into a classroom which denied creativity and flexibility, and we need to transform that education system into the 21st century where we can excite kids and challenge kids and show them their future. And we need all of your help to get that done. But, you know, we've achieved a lot, and I could go on, but it would bore me more than it would bore you. But we should be proud of what we've done. You have to celebrate your wins. You have to celebrate your victories, but we're nowhere near done yet, not by a mile. You know, Beth Hansen said, you know, some governors would come in and sort of rest on this. We're not resting. We're just getting started. In fact, by getting out of the ditch and starting to move forward, the road ahead has come back into view. We can now see the future, and as we look down that road, we realize that in some ways the stakes are higher now than they were 4 years ago, because we've made progress. Now we have more to lose. Not only do we have a future to reach out and claim, but we've got to be good stewards of what we've already achieved, what we've already accomplished. As we look ahead, let's not make a big mistake. Let's not make a big mistake. Let's not get comfortable. We can't start thinking that we've done enough. We can't stop pursuing dynamic change. Yeah, we can pause at moments, only for a moment, to catch our breath and power up, but thinking that we can begin to ease up and slow down, that's a deception. Getting comfortable with the status quo and being unwilling to take chances. Think about this. Getting comfortable with the status quo and not wanting to take chances, it's just too hard. It's why Ohio got so far off the track, and not just in recent memory, but over the past few generations. We began to think our success was our birthright, that we would always be an economic powerhouse. We just thought it was just in our DNA, and a place where good jobs were just a way of life. What did we think? We could just show up, and it would be handed to us? We became blind to new opportunities that could have helped launch us into the future. These exciting new industries, they arose in other places. because we didn't hold on to the creativity and curiosity that drove great innovators of the past. The Wright brothers, Edison, the list goes on and on about who we are. And make no mistake, if we're not innovating and growing and changing, we're dying and there's nothing in between. Throughout human history, throughout the history of the world, those institutions which embraced innovation, risk-taking, and a certain fearlessness, they achieved great results for those they served. We've had that spirit before in Ohio. The first frontier, the golden age of industrial innovation. We believe we're on the verge of recapturing that spirit. And what is that spirit? Strength, confidence, vision. I can see the future and I will grab that future. The question is today, do we have the courage to take the next steps together? Are we able to think of the common good? Of the common good, not just our own personal gains. This is not rhetoric. Are we able to think what's best for all and not just what's best for us? Do we want to be part of a team that creates a legacy that is remembered for generations to come? Like we think about Edison and the Wright brothers and the development of the Cleveland Clinic and so many wonderful things in this state. Wouldn't we like to be remembered as doing something special to boost our state? Wouldn't you like to be part of an effort that is driving Ohio into the 21st century? And I tell you what's happening. It's forcing America to wake up and recognize that Ohio is more and more a land of progress, a land of success, and a land of opportunity. Ladies and gentlemen, this requires us to look at life in a different way. To look at life as a real calling. Our efforts should benefit those around us, but also benefit those who we may never meet. Today, many opine on dysfunction in America, our inability to work together as a team, and our inability to sacrifice immediate gratification in order to create long-term good. I want it now. I want it now. It's toxic. The answers to how we can best work together isn't a mystery, though sometimes it seems to be so hard to find. Courage, work together. How did they ever get off those barges? Try to take the beach. Most of the early arrivals on D-Day, they knew they weren't going to make it. They weren't going home. They wouldn't kiss their wife or see their children, but somehow they got off those barges because they had courage for the long-term good. The answers are before us. If we slow down and look and study, they are in each of us when we are at our best, and they have been found in these greatest of Americans in generations past. But folks, I think the erosion of basic values that made our nation great is the most serious problem facing our state and our nation today. And I'm not talking about those volatile issues. You know, you fight about them on talk radio or you see them on, you know, political television. I'm talking about foundational bedrock values, and they're undeniably common to us, the ones we all want our children and our grandchildren to embrace, like personal responsibility, resilience, empathy, teamwork, family, faith. We all know that those values have weakened, and it is essential that we come together and restore them. And I think what some people miss is don't deal with just the symptoms. Deal with the problem. Restoring these values will allow us to have greater courage, to confront greed, to confront frustration, to confront alienation, if we practice those values. And first, I'd like to start with personal responsibility. We all have a duty to do our part for our communities, for our families, and to be accountable to ourselves. Remember this when you were a kid? We need to own our own actions and be responsible for our own decisions. Don't blame others. There are no excuses. Take responsibility for yourself. Own your life. Own it. It's yours. It's as exciting as you want to make it. The dog ate my homework, went out in the fourth grade. It's not a way to live your life. When I think about personal responsibility, I think about a friend of mine, Cynthia Dungy. Cynthia's here. She leads Ohio's Department of Jobs and Family Services. She grew up poor. Poor. She could have just, you know, said, well, it's not my fault, I blame some, but she didn't. She worked hard, she won a scholarship, went on to graduate from college, and then she, of course, earned her law degree. She's someone who has always owned her decisions. She kept herself centered on what matters. She now leads a department with a $3.7 billion budget whose mission is helping others learn personal responsibility and to lift themselves up. She and I both know that government can be a partner with us. With us, with private citizens, to help when needed, Mayor, to help when needed. But government should never drive us to a state of dependency. Dependency. Dependent. Not on drugs, not on someone else, and not on government. You know, it's like my mom always used to tell me, God bless her, hey, it's a sin not to help someone who needs it, but it's equally a sin to continue to help someone who needs how to learn to help themselves. It's a sin not to help someone who needs it, but it's equally a sin to continue to help someone who needs how to learn help themselves. And when we manage government efficiently, we can figure this out. It can help those who cannot help themselves, and in some cases, it can be a temporary way station. And do not be bitter at people that need temporary help. Do not be that way. My own father was in the Civilian Conservation Corps before he was taken into the military. His son's here speaking to you today. John Kennedy spoke of personal responsibility when he said, "Ask not what your country can do for you." Glorious words. But what you can do for your country. Great wisdom then, wasn't it? But we want to consider a new approach today. Don't ask what someone else can do for you, but what you can do to help yourself and to help someone else. That should be our new refrain here in the 21st century. Resilience, you know, resilience, it's a tough one, you know. It isn't always easy to take responsibility for the things that happen in our lives. I mean, crazy things happen all the time. Life isn't always easy, but a life strategy built around simply avoiding everything that's hard or painful, it's doomed to fail. It's shallow. It's the easy way. It's shallow. It leads us to also miss out on some of the great joys of life that await us after difficulties. Adversity builds character. Adversity can make you better. Adversity never fails to humble us because it shows us what our weaknesses are. And we explore what is going on in our lives. But if we stand tall in the middle of a storm, do you know how much stronger we are? Do you know how much more we can celebrate? And when we practice resiliency ourselves, we must teach our children so they can learn how to bounce back and pick themselves up after a fall. And we need to teach our children that you don't just get a trophy for showing up. It's about picking yourself up and making something of yourself. You're going to love this. Americans always love the story of the underdog, the person who continues to fight in spite of having the worst conditions thrown at them. You know why? Because America is inherently a resilient nation. We are. And we celebrate that value wherever we see it. We see it in true heroes like Ohio's Colonel Tom Moe. Young Tom Moe. He served our country in Vietnam. Young pilot. Story only starts there. Flying a mission, his plane shot down. Imprisoned in the Hanoi Hilton. He was put in solitary confinement for 9 months, spoke to no other American, didn't give him much food, almost no food. He was transferred to another prison, and every day, every single day, they came in and they beat him, bloody, to a pulp. By the time he left, his ribs were broken, internal bleeding, bruised kidneys, the list goes on and on, but he never gave up. Kept picking himself up, kept living. He left that prison, he came home, and he continued to serve the military, and then for nearly 3 years in my administration, he was the voice of veterans across Ohio as he led the Department of Veterans Affairs. He spent more than 5 years as a prisoner of war, facing adversity that we can only begin to imagine. And in spite of that, you will never meet a person with more life and more resilience inside of them. Join me in thanking Colonel Tom Moe. Where is Colonel Moe? There he is, right up at there, right up at the first balcony. Love you, Colonel. You know, that resiliency that Colonel Moe developed, it not only strengthened his own life, but it also became a strength he could share with others. Think about this. My view, and I know him and I love him, the pain that he endured led him to understand the challenges and problems of others. His pain allowed him to understand our struggles. He developed empathy. It's an essential value today. Our country and our state are polarized. That is a fact. It keeps us from working as a team and quite simply divides us. A large part of this stems from the fact that we seem unable anymore to put ourselves in someone else's shoes. If you can't feel somebody else, you just don't get it. You know why it's happened? Too fixated on ourselves. It's all about me. And somehow, we have lost the beautiful sound of our neighbors' voices. Moving beyond ourselves and trying to share in the experience of others helps us open our minds, allows us to grow as people. It helps us to become less self-righteous. Do you ever find that in yourself? I do. Self-righteous allows you to be more righteous. Empathy is the first ingredient in compassion. and makes it possible for us to care enough to begin to reach out to those who have been forgotten, disenfranchised, ignored, or who are suffering, and to reach out to them in the way they need. Empathy is about respecting others enough to learn what they feel and think, and there's no better person who models empathy than Tracy Plouk. Tracy leads the Ohio Department of Mental Health and Addiction Services. I want to thank the legislature for the fact that they have understood that we never kept our promise to those who might live under a bridge or fight an addiction. Well, Tracy Plouk, she not only runs this Ohio department and is the shining leader of this department, she does have to do some other things. So she's a volunteer for the emergency suicide hotline. I mean, she just didn't have enough to do. And she was one of the greatest advocates for the poor with her support of Medicaid expansion. 2 years ago, Tracy came to my office. I can't even quite remember why she was there to talk to me about some matter. She said, "Tracy, want me to expand Medicaid?" She said, "Governor, I pray every single night that you will do it." I said, "Tracy, your prayers are answered, because I am going to ask the General Assembly to do it." And when she left our meeting, she went outside of my office and she cried. She broke down in tears of both relief and joy. And she does that because she cares about people. She puts herself in their shoes. She knows how to feel both their sorrows and their victories. God bless you, Tracy. Where are you today? God bless you for what you do for these folks. In a time of such deep divisions in our country, I believe we need this type of empathy now more than ever. It not only helps us to care for each other, but how about this? But also during a disagreement, consider for a moment somebody else may be right, that there might be another, better way. And in the course, we can come together in a way that makes us all stronger. Let me be clear. Just because someone has a different opinion, it doesn't make them an enemy. And you think about the fighting that goes on at a level that is breathtaking. We need to welcome different points of view, and you know why? Because it makes America strong. Diversity of opinion makes us stronger. And when we come together, we start the process of building teams. That's why teamwork is so important, with shared visions and missions, and we can get so much more done. Okay, can you believe that I knew Woody Hayes? Okay, one of the greatest men I ever met. He didn't have a shoe contract. He didn't have a uniform contract. He took nothing. And when he was done with his career, his players bought him a pickup truck. See, Woody was the expert on teamwork. He said, "You win with people. Get the book. You win with people." He didn't say you win with one really good person. He didn't say that you can be really good all by yourself. He said people. And it's a plural word. It takes a group of people committed to their own performance, yet all pulling together in the same direction to win. We are made for each other, and without each other, we can never be our best. By coming together to achieve our goals and work through our differences while still respecting the traits that make us special and unique, we only improve ourselves and we make our common way smoother. Teamwork is about understanding there's more to life than just yourself. It's about all of us. One of the things that we hear most in our country is, why do the people we elect and send to Washington not work together? Well, I was there with my great friend Rob Portman, and there were times when we came together to serve our country. And we did it by working as a team, not by tearing each other down so we could build ourselves up. We are Ohioans. We are Americans. We can't be partisans, and we cannot be extreme ideologues if we're going to deal with the problems in America. Americans and Ohioans are hungry to see people work together, to build better communities, to build a better Ohio, to build a better nation. But let's also never forget what one of the great building blocks of this nation is: family. Family. We must remember how important it is to value our families. Remember your life as a kid? Loved, guided. Got to figure out a way, Mayor, how when those don't have family, somehow maybe we can substitute. I don't know. But the family's been the bedrock of America since the beginning. The family means stronger children. The family means stronger neighborhoods. The family means stronger communities. The family means a stronger Ohio, and the family means a stronger America. We must stand up and fight for the family again. We must never give up in strengthening America's families, because it makes America good and makes America great. We know families are a special creation with a mission of nurturing us and helping us grow. I believe we're all created unique and special. Not all of you, one at a time. Unique and special. And when we understand that we were individually created for something bigger than ourselves, it unleashes within us the power of the infinite. That's why we need to talk about faith. With that knowledge, we can come to understand our purpose. And in some way, the obstacles of life will not derail us from our mission. I was told that the largest growing number of addicted people in Ohio are young women between the ages of 18 and 25. I'm sure some of it is injury, some of it is health. But when you don't understand, you've never been explained to you that the Lord created you for a purpose. If you do understand it, you can fight off the obstacles of life, because you know you have a special purpose. And we're all made special with gifts that are unique to each of us, and we don't measure the gifts. Just somebody that will go visit somebody who's sick is special. No small amount of good that is done is ever lost in eternity. It never will be. The key to satisfaction in life is to open those gifts and actually use them. Think about how good we feel when we use those gifts. And remember, hard to believe sometimes, we're not on this world to accumulate things. We're not on here to keep up with the Joneses and outrun everyone else. We're here to serve and to love and to heal, in keeping with the spirit of a power far greater than ourselves, a power that calls us, challenges us to join in the mission of healing. And when we have knowledge that we are made special, it lifts the scales from our eyes, and we see before us the mountain we are called to climb. A great man of great faith who gave his life for what he believed was the German Lutheran minister Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He opposed Hitler and the Nazis from the earliest days, and when others stayed silent, he spoke out. The Nazis, they did not know how to deal with Minister Dietrich. For 10 years, they were afraid to imprison him, and when they finally put him in prison, his message still found a way out. The end was closing in. Himmler ordered the execution of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. It is reported that as they led Bonhoeffer to the gallows in that prison, a guard testified that he had never seen a person more comfortable and more confident of his faith than Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He believed in life ever after, and he believed he was on earth to serve the Lord. Nazi Germany is relegated to the ash bin of history. But Dietrich Bonhoeffer stands triumphant, Bruce, stands triumphant. He stands as a shining example of the power that one person can have on the world forever when they're true to their faith and let themselves become a vessel for the Lord. He was just one man, but he mattered. His message inspired millions. So folks, remember, your life and your mission is important to the world. That's not trite. It's my opinion, but your life matters to the world. Our world, our nation, our state, your community, they're all made up of people just like you. And these places are only as strong, as good as you decide to make them, because you know what? We're all part of a great mosaic. Our commitment, our efforts, our character, these are what make America great. America didn't achieve what it has achieved because of government. America has always been about the character, the tenacity, the goodness of its people, and our nation is as strong as we choose to be, as you choose to be. I ask you today, what are you doing to build a stronger community, a stronger Ohio? What are you doing to build on the work of those who came before us and those who made the ultimate sacrifice? I know you agree there are values that are important to live by and cultivate, that your contribution, your legacy matters. Then join me in acting today wherever you are. Here in Ohio, we know that these values matter and that they can change people's lives. Personal responsibility, empathy, teamwork, family, faith, and you've got some others, and we're seeing it here, but there's more to do. We're creating pathways so you can put these values to work in your community. Don't rely on government. In your community, you, through such efforts as our teen anti-drug use program, Start Talking, our student mentoring effort, in the classroom, giving kids hope and direction, community connectors, our initiative to help the disabled find meaningful work, Employment First. And as you know, Mayor, our work to reduce infant mortality with leaders in the community who have credibility with the folks that need the help. These are all opportunities for us to roll up our sleeves and practice what we believe and what we know works. These are opportunities to give of ourselves and help someone else find their way. Because I happen to believe that some of the toughest problems that face our society can only be solved if we turn on the light in someone else's life. Then it can make two lives brighter. It can shine a light on the way forward for all of us. You know, we've been great as individuals in a nation when we have the courage to let go of ourselves, to feel the pull of a greater power. Our future together is going to be as strong and prosperous and joyous as you want to make it. Yeah, there's a lot of work involved, but when we get together and we see what we achieve, a fire burns, and we want to work even harder because we relish in the constant churn and forward motion that teams can make. This is the path forward for us. It is the path I choose and try to walk every day. And it is the path that I will chart for the next 4 years as governor of Ohio. I will continue to nurture a climate in which the dignity of hard work is respected and it pays off. And entrepreneurs can create and innovate. I will continue to build a system for people to learn and grow throughout their lives and reach their God-given potential. I will continue to make sure we are able to catch each other if we fall and help those who struggle live with the dignity and grace deserving a child of God. And I will continue to put people and their freedoms over government because government is for us and by us, not the other way around. And I will go about all of this by embracing change and innovation and by working every day to bring us together. I will work to the best of my ability to tear down the barriers that divide us and to show us that we can be stronger together. And when my work is done, I hope Ohioans are more than just better off. I hope we have a better way, that we have a new way of seeing our shared work together. I hope I will have helped Ohioans see how much good can be achieved when we laugh at the impossible and just go for it. May God bless Ohio, and may God bless each and every one of us. Thank you all very much.